A fortnight in the sun just isn't enough for some plucky Brits.
Why would we want to be anywhere else?
So they're giving up the day jobs and moving to the four corners of Europe.
Yes.
Whoa, this is very amazing and beautiful.
Join us as we follow them taking a leap of faith.
Who dares wins.
No going back.
So this is it, the start of a new life.
Selling furniture in Portugal, running surfing holidays in Spain.
So this is our home.
And launching cafes in France.
Blimey.
But are they on the path to glory?
Gotcha.
Or the road to nowhere?
Oh, my goodness.
So, Houston, we have a problem.
Oh, my God. I'm making this worse.
As they begin their new lives in the sun.
Very pleasant.
We are 100% here to stay.
Today in Spain.
There we go.
A Nottinghamshire family dream big, but can they transform this dated villa into a high-end B&B?
Needs modernising, definitely.
I think that we could have it all done, sorted out and ready to go within a month.
Well, that's optimistic.
Two hospitality entrepreneurs team up in Almeria.
This doing anything?
No.
But will power problems turn their dream restaurant into a money pit?
There's wires cut off everywhere.
It's like Spaghetti Junction. There are so many wires.
And in France...
Our family and friends think we're moving out to a glamorous life, drinking pina coladas.
A northeast couple battle drab decor at their new rural retreat.
It hasn't been used for nearly a year, so as you can see, it's not guest ready.
With an average annual temperature of 17 degrees and some of the mildest winters in Europe, the Costa del Sol is a mecca for sun-starved Brits. Warm winters, a laid-back lifestyle and a strong expat community make this one of the most popular regions in Europe for Brits to relocate. And Brexit red tape hasn't dimmed our appetite to move here, with 11,000 people trading Blighty for Spain in the last 12 months.
Darling, do you want some big pants?
One couple who decided that life was too short to put off that dream move...
Like it?
No.
..are Sarah and Luther from Nottinghamshire.
It was a definite no, that one.
We had a series of five friends within a year pass away, and they were all very young, far too young, and it just made us think we need to do something about this and change our lifestyle.
When they chose to move to sunnier climes, barrister Sarah and former landlord Luther were originally looking to set up a B&B on the English Riviera. But they soon decided to ditch Torbay for Benalmádena, where Luther's dad already lives.
And we were looking at Cornwall, Devon, to start a B&B. And it was Sarah's wonderful idea. She said, we don't know anybody down in Cornwall or Devon, so why go there? Why not get close to where your father is and enjoy the weather?
After selling up in Nottinghamshire, Sarah and Luther bought this seven-bedroom villa that they hope to transform into a luxury B&B. The house comes with a swimming pool and striking panoramic views, and all for the price of the average flat in London.
It's situated in between Mijas and Fuengirola, close to the airports, and we've bought somewhere that we can live upstairs, and the downstairs is bedrooms and a studio apartment for our guests.
The couple are hoping their new venture will fix their work-life balance so they can spend more time with son Monty.
My work back home is extremely taxing, and the whole idea is that my job takes a bit of a back seat.
The idea is that Sarah has a more relaxing role in this, and so the idea is that I do everything and Sarah does nothing.
Makes a change.
Yeah.
It's February, and Sarah and Luther are applying for golden visas, a status granted to Brits who invest big in the region. They now have 90 days to submit their application, during which time they're free to live here. So today they're in Malaga to sign the papers for their new home.
We've finally completed.
The solicitor turned up. He didn't rob us of all our money. It's all done. We're now the proud owners of Casa Hermosa.
We have the keys.
Yay! So this is it, the start of a new life.
The couple only looked around the house once before buying it, so they're hoping there are no nasty surprises lurking inside.
Come here. Come here. Come on. Here we go.
In the end, it's quite the opposite.
It's spotless, which is always a bonus.
Sarah and Luther plan to live with son Monty on the first floor. Here there are two bedrooms, a large living space and kitchen, plus two bathrooms and a private terrace.
Are you coming, Bella?
Downstairs there are five more bedrooms, most with an ensuite bathroom. Perfect for Sarah and Luther's B&B plans.
It's massive. If you're as tall as me, you can see the Atlas Mountains there across the Med. You can see the sea over in that corner there. And if the wife allows me to chop down these trees, you'll be able to see down to Gibraltar.
But there is some room for improvement.
That's got to go.
Yeah.
Gone.
It needs modernising, definitely. So there's a lot of expense, which we were aware of.
To save money, Sarah and Luther plan to revamp the house themselves.
So this all really needs redoing. Look at this. This is shabby.
This just needs painting and a couple of tiles sticking back on.
But while they share a vision for the end result, when it comes to timescale, they're poles apart.
I think that we could have it all done, sorted out and ready to go within a month.
Well, that's optimistic. I think we'll be at least 3 months.
The Spanish holiday market is competitive, so the couple will need to work hard to find their niche in the B&B market. But for now, it's time to soak up the scenery and celebrate the start of their new life together.
I am slightly excited. Admittedly, I do not feel my years at this moment in time. We've actually done it.
We're here at last.
South of Normandy, in northwest France, sits the humble department of Mayenne, a region 20 times the size of Birmingham, but with just a quarter of the population. For only €18,000, you could pick up a riverside plot here, or for just a few thousand euros more, a three-bedroomed house to develop. And it was the temptation of country living that made former paramedic Maxine and graphic designer Graham ditch England's northeast for France's northwest.
Who's a good girl?
Yeah, no, stay there.
When they met over 2 decades ago, the couple shared a dream of running a country retreat. But when Maxine's dad was diagnosed with dementia, they put family first.
Dad relied on us a lot. So we put plans on hold for, 10, 15 years?
Yeah.
And sadly, Dad passed away a couple of years ago, and we just thought, right, this is our time now. Didn't want to sound selfish at all, but we put everything plans on hold for so many years, this just felt it was time we did it, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Like Sarah and Luther, Maxine and Graham's property search began in Britain, but during a French road trip, they also discovered their money went a lot further in mainland Europe.
There's always been a want to maybe work in hospitality, run a bed and breakfast.
Looked all over, didn't we?
Yeah.
In the UK.
All over the UK. We viewed quite a lot in the Lake District. Nothing was quite right. And it was just, as soon as we came out on holiday in France, it was like, yeah, this is it.
Here in the quaint village of Saint-Aubin-du-Désert, 50 kilometres from Le Mans, Maxine and Graham discovered pastoral perfection. This stunning three-bedroom farmhouse with separate three-bedroom gîte set in 2.5 acres of land.
We bought the property for £300,000.
Where we lived, we'd have got a three-bedroom detached with a very small garden on the middle of a housing estate.
It's so much more value for money, isn't it?
Yeah.
To fund their future life here, Maxine and Graham plan to rent out the gîte and convert part of the estate into a motorhome park. But their plans all depend on planning approval. And with their life savings on the line, the stakes couldn't be higher.
Financially, we've gone all out.
Yeah.
I think if you're going to do it, you've got to go all out. You've got to jump in with 2 feet, 4 feet, and give it a go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you only live once.
Yeah.
It's March and Maxine and Graham made the permanent move to France only yesterday.
Yeah, our family and friends think we're moving out to a glamorous life, drinking pina coladas. Yeah. In the summer, maybe. There you go, that can go.
In order to secure 12-month work visas, Maxine and Graham had to provide proof of income in France. But because their new business has yet to see a customer, let alone turn a profit, Graham will continue to work remotely.
Initially, we were given misinformation about visas. We were told that all we had to do was move to France because it was permanent, because we were buying a property. All we had to do was then go to the mayor's office and apply for residency. Yeah, that's not the case. You can't just do that now. But anyway, once we found out what we had to do, we've got a lady in France who's talked us through it. She's been fantastic. It was just long-winded, really, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Their work visas top a very short list of possessions the couple travel to France with.
We don't have any furniture yet, apart from some dining room chairs that we brought back, only because the people who bought our house wanted to buy furniture.
All the furniture.
And we thought, oh, great idea, that's great. Saves on shipping costs. However, we've got nothing to sit on much.
Luckily, the self-contained Jeep that they planned to rent out came fully furnished.
As you can see, it's not guest ready. It is as we bought it, basically.
Yeah.
But the couple have their work cut out updating the outmoded decor. Luckily, the building's period features give it instant curb appeal.
We're into what is a twin room, which I love, the old doors.
To minimise renovation costs, Maxine and Graham plan to refresh and upcycle as much of the existing furniture as possible.
It hasn't been used for nearly a year, so a really good clean decoration, yeah. Making sure everything's just absolutely perfect.
And the couple aren't messing around. They want to start turning a profit as soon as possible, and they already have their first booking.
So we've got 4 weeks. We thought we had 8 weeks, and then yesterday we took a booking for Easter weekend. Deadlines are good.
But can Maxine and Graham adjust to country life and get the Jeep guest ready in less than a month? In the province of Almería in southeast Spain, nestling in the foothills of the Sierra Cabrera mountain range, sits the picturesque, whitewashed village of Mojaca. Once a significant fortress settlement built to ward off invaders, it's now a popular tourist destination that welcomes new settlers with open arms.
There looks like a lot of people with their swimming caps out there.
Beautiful, isn't it?
Two of which are Fraser from Yorkshire and his business partner, Jeanette.
It's a Spanish secret, Mojaca. Not many Brits know about it. So it's not built up, it's not a typical Benidorm. The Spanish keep it to themselves. And that's why it's special, because it's untouched.
This couple of experienced hospitality entrepreneurs are new to Mojaca, but not to Spain. Fraser recently owned a cafe bar and food truck, and Jeanette has run a successful chain of restaurants.
We've had three in the Torrevieja region. Then COVID came along, so we had to let one go. And then we battled through COVID and come out the other side. So we're lucky really still to be in business. So we count ourselves blessed.
After previously running separate businesses, Fraser and Jeanette have now decided to partner up and plan to open a restaurant at this beachfront property with stunning sea views, which they've leased together.
This location is special. It's got a certain vibe to it. You open those restaurant doors, you walk through, you see this. It's not like coming to work. It's enjoyable. There's not one day where I wake up and think, oh, I've got to go to work. Yeah, never.
Jeanette and Fraser know better than most how competitive the market is, but they're hoping their combined talents will set them above the rest. And with everything thrown in, this time they can't afford to fail.
There's a very popular saying that I've seen for many years. Some people want it to happen and some people make it happen. I have always been a make it happen person, so if I set my mind to something, I will do it.
It'll be tough, but I'm sure we'll do it.
It's mid-January. Fraser and Jeanette got the keys to their new property just 8 days ago, and they've wasted no time getting stuck into renovating their new restaurant.
So, we are changing things. More than a bit. There used to be a bar here, literally to here. Far too big, took up too much room, so that's gone. We're having an open bar on this wall with a return. There was a wall. Now, where there's no longer a wall, so we're going to have an open kitchen. That's where we're going to serve from. If you come through to the kitchen, which there's still a lot of work to do in here, we're going to have sort of like a big island here. That's going to be the dessert room. That's going to be Jeanette's office.
As well as overhauling the inside, Jeanette wants to transform the outside terrace, which will allow them to seat another 50 customers.
Our plans are to have tables and chairs out here on the front, and then on the area that's actually on the other side of us is going to be an easy seating area. We have a 75-year-old dead olive tree, and that's travelled with us now to 4 different restaurants. My plan for that this time is to have it out here on the terrace, and I'm going to have a painted canopy.
Although they've made good progress so far completing all the structural work, there's a lot to do. And to keep costs low, Fraser, Jeanette and her husband Alan are tackling most jobs themselves.
Oh, my God. I'm making this worse.
It's going to get wallpapered anyway, so I shall make sure it's all good before when the wallpaper goes on.
But money is already a worry.
We're doing whatever we can to save money, and that's why we're doing everything ourselves.
After relocating and leasing the restaurant, they only have a limited amount of money left to see them through. So they've set themselves an ambitious deadline, which they really need to hit.
We're aiming to open on the 14th of February. So, 4 weeks. All systems go? All systems go.
Coming up...
That sounds like water.
Damp problems for Maxine and Graham.
Oh, and it's dripping from there.
It's starting to get worse.
And Sarah and Luther.
That's a lot worse than I thought. This has obviously been a long-standing problem. Hey, up!
In northwest France, wannabe holiday hosts Maxine and Graham are under pressure to get their gîte up and running before their first guests arrive just over a month from now.
That's Graham's job to take it up there and dump it.
But first they need to get their own house in order, starting with the heating.
I've only lived for 3 weeks, so I hope I remember how to do it, to be honest.
Yeah, we haven't had a lot of training on it, have we, so...
So that's the first thing.
Here in Mayenne, the average temperature in April is only a few degrees higher than their native northeast. But since the house is not connected to the gas mains, the couple will rely on this wood gasification boiler to keep the cold at bay.
The one back in the UK was gas. You know, you just switch it on.
And it went on.
This one, it's all wood.
And it's fabulous when it works. Yeah. It takes some learning how to do it.
During the winter, this wood boiler will power Maxine and Graham's underfloor heating.
Open the bottom one.
But their hot water comes from a separate electrical boiler.
But basically, we'll just start packing it, put some highlighters in.
And in the summer, solar panels fitted to the house will provide the couple with free green energy.
I had some lovely lessons off the people who bought it off, but that was a long time ago.
I see that it's starting to take hold.
Yeah.
To see them through the rest of spring, Maxine and Graham just had 5 tons of wood delivered at a cost of €450.
Here we go, you ready?
So when Graham said we had a delivery of wood coming, didn't quite expect the delivery of wood we've got, but apparently it'll last us till the end of May. Heavier stuff on.
Maxine and Graham are determined to embrace off-grid life.
Two more bits and then.
But it's fair to say that living without home comforts may take some getting used to.
Graham, I hate to tell you, is that a warning light come on?
I think it is, yeah.
We've got to try and reset it, which Graham's doing now. You know, in the UK, you push the button, your gas boiler starts, your hot water's instant, and when we bought the house, it was right, it's a wood gasification boiler, it's really efficient, it works no problem, and we went, OK. There we go.
There we go. Can you hear the fan kicking in?
Boiler sorted, now there's another problem.
That sounds like water. Yeah. Oh, and it's dripping from there.
Oh, yeah. That was soaked.
Water is pouring down the boiler room wall, and they have no idea where it's coming from.
It's starting to get worse, so I'm going to attempt to take this off so I can see what is going on underneath here.
This wall backs onto Maxine and Graham's living room and bedroom, so any leak here could cause a serious damp issue.
Soak that. There's a water pipe coming along.
Uh-huh.
It seems to go up, and that's where the water seems to be coming from.
But it couldn't have been a worse
place.
Yeah.
I think it could be the hot water pipe to go to the radiator that's in the back bedroom. Now, whether it's since we've put the heating back on, sprung a leak, but it's definitely coming down, but that's definitely the cause of the problem. So it's not a leak in the roof or anything like that, it's a leak in that pipe.
Stemming the leak just topped Maxine and Graham's to-do list. They should be focusing on getting their Jeep guest ready, so the timing couldn't be worse.
I'm concerned because it looks like we're going to have to take a wall down in the bedroom to get to it, to mend it. And it's something, when we've only got 4 weeks to get the Jeep ready, it's something we really could do without.
It's mid-March in southern Spain, where Sarah, Luther and son Monty are still getting used to the rigours of Costa living.
You don't like the bugs in the pool, do you, Monty?
Absolutely not.
Bugs aren't allowed to go in the pool. You went in yesterday, didn't you?
Yeah, freezing.
The family just bought this 7-bed villa with plans to transform it into a high-end B&B. They hope this swimming pool, complete with panoramic views, will be a big selling point. But they just hit a slight financial bump in the road getting it guest ready.
We went to have a look at sun lounges yesterday and there were €170 a pop, which I can't believe. But anyway, come back and we've got a load of these as dirty as that. So I jet washed it and it came up like that. So now Sarah's going to be doing the other 10 and we save ourselves €1,700.
And the sun loungers aren't the only inherited terraced furniture the couple are looking to upcycle.
Thank you. I haven't painted since I was at school, a long time ago. But this is a very dirty table, which has come up quite nicely. And no point throwing it away.
While Sarah and Monty take care of business poolside, inside, Luther has begun redecorating the first of their 5 guest bedrooms.
Everything is going according to plan.
But Luther may have spoken too soon.
Hey, that's not funny. That's a lot worse than I thought. This is obviously been a long-standing problem. I think they've had a problem with condensation. The building's 30 years old. So you're going to have problems.
Luckily, the water damage is only superficial, and once the cracked plaster is filled, the wall can be repainted.
I'm going to have to make considerable more than this, and I won't make it in my coffee cup either.
Outside, it looks like Sarah is having much more luck than her husband.
How many have you done?
3. No, 2, but we've done 3 in total.
They look amazing.
Got 4 more to go and they're getting dirtier and dirtier as they go down the pile. And so every time I have cleaned one, when it dries, it still looks a little bit dirty, so I'm having to go over them a couple of times.
By the end of the day, Luther has worked his magic and the first of their guest bedrooms is painted. Now they're ready to kickstart their marketing campaign.
We're making this bed up so that we can start advertising out. And we want to have the first two rooms ready for next Saturday. Hopefully by the end of March, we'll have all five rooms done.
Can I just say, this room looks fantastic, White.
I think it looks absolutely perfect.
Looks much better.
4 days from now, the couple have invited a friend from the UK to come and test drive the B&B experience.
Well, mine looks a lot better than yours.
You reckon?
And with a few finishing touches...
Watch me paint.
I don't love it, but it can stay for now.
The bedroom is finally set.
It's been exhausting. We've done a lot.
The weather has been ridiculously hot. I have probably lost about 4 kilos.
Good.
And I won't have to breathe in for future reference. I'll be as fit as a butcher's by the time we finish this.
So it's now time to enjoy a little bit of cheeky wine and a beer by the pool.
What a wonderful idea. It's been a great day. I like this new life.
It's a great start for Sarah and Luther, but the couple are still a long way from realising their vision for a luxury B&B in the sun. Coming up, Fraser turns detective.
Fans are here. And I'm guessing they're knackered.
To solve the case of the missing extractor fan.
These have been disconnected for some reason.
So we're going to need a new one.
And as renovations ramp up in France...
There's something pretty odd in the corner.
Maxine turns archaeologist.
Whoa, what is that?
Back in southeast Spain, it's all hands to the pump to turn Jeanette and Fraser's bottomed-out bar into a top-class restaurant in just under 4 weeks' time.
We'll do it, won't we all?
Yeah.
We'll get there. Where's the world is away.
They've already knocked down walls and created an open kitchen, but there's still tiling to do, wallpaper to hang, rewiring and plumbing to complete, and a bar to build. And their opening deadline isn't the only one looming. They need to finish most of the building work in the restaurant in just 4 days' time to make way for an important delivery.
Monday's a huge day, delivery day of all the furniture that's in storage. And it's going to fill this space. It'll fill all this with the kitchen equipment, the restaurant, the outside furniture. It's a full restaurant in the back of a truck, and I'm talking a HGV truck. Huge. So, yeah, all this space on Monday, I'll be full of boxes, piled high, and then it'll be another week unpacking. There's a fair bit to do before Monday, but we'll get there. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, we've got 3 more days.
Today, they're taking a look at the electrics to make sure everything has power and is working. But it's looking like they might need a professional.
This doing anything?
Nope.
On, off, so I can stay off.
To sort them out.
There's wires cut off everywhere, so you don't know if these wires cut off are missing, like, breaking a circuit or something.
It's like Spaghetti Junction. Basically, we're just trying to get the toilet lights working and... we can't find a switch for them. But there are so many wires.
While Jeanette tries to figure out which wires lead where, Fraser's hoping to shed some light on another electrical issue.
The extractor unit in the kitchen. We don't think there's a fan to pull the smoke. So I'm going to go up on the roof and check to see if there's one there or not.
So Fraser decides to head up top to try and get to the bottom of the problem. But first they need to figure out which vent is which.
Sarah! I don't want to put my hand in.
Once located...
Is this canopy?
It doesn't take long for Fraser to solve the mystery.
Fans are here. And I'm guessing they're knackered. So that's why it's not turning on. So we need a new one, because these have been disconnected for some reason. More expense.
With not much money in the pot, It's an unforeseen cost they can't really afford. And Fraser still has to break the bad news to Jeanette.
And there's no motor in here?
No. See, there's power there to it, here, but nothing connected. So I'm guessing at one point, these were the units.
So we're going to need a new one.
With less than 4 weeks to go till their opening deadline, having to buy and fit the new extractor could blow both their schedule and their budget.
More money. So what happens when you move bars? You know, you've sorted out all the problems over 4 years, all your enchufas and this, that and the other, and you replace it all, and then you go somewhere new and you have to start all over again, basically.
Back in Mayenne, it's early March, and Maxine and Graham are still getting used to off-grid life on their 2.5-acre French estate.
The fence has fallen down, so we're going to see if we can put these new fence posts in.
Yeah.
Come on, then. Give it a go.
Right. God, this is heavy.
Who needs to go to the gym? What? Watch my fingers.
All right.
Ordinarily, fence maintenance wouldn't be a priority for the couple.
That's it, it's going in.
Is that going in,
yeah,
is
yeah,
it?
Yeah.
But a plethora of wildlife roam the local woodlands, a spectacle to behold, but not something they want to see on their doorstep. Hopefully, these repairs should keep the wildlife at bay.
It's getting very near my leg. There you go. See?
Yeah, some of that.
I come up with the ideas, you do the work.
Yeah.
Fence fixed, inside there's more cause for celebration. The leaky pipe is no more.
I've been checking it on and off today and everything's dry. The leak isn't a leak anymore, it's gone. So, totally random. So what I'll do is though, I'll leave the ceiling down, see if it starts again, but yeah, everything's nice and dry.
Now the couple have another wild problem to curtail. This outbuilding, which doubles as a laundry room, has become overgrown with ivy, meaning guests currently have nowhere to wash their clothes. But this is one job Maxine has been dreading.
I'd like to get it all down today, but we'll see. But I've cut ivy down before in the UK and ended up with a bad chest with all the dust, hence the mask.
If left untamed, the ivy could compromise the roof structure, but cutting it back won't be a straightforward task.
Some electrical cables running through. Chunky cables, so I've just been so careful not to cut them by accident.
If we get it out from under the eaves, we've cracked it. It's just, with that electrical cable there, it's just really worrying, isn't it? We can't pull and push as much as we want, can we?
No.
It's up into the roof trusses here. Massively. Hey, what, I'm hot now.
While Graham untangles the ivy at roof level, Maxine has made an unusual find down below.
There's something pretty odd in the corner, and I'm not sure I want to pick it out. It looks like a doll, but it's a funny colour. I'm sure it's just a doll. Ooh. Ah. What is that? Well, I hope it's a good luck thing.
As it turns out, Lady Luck is on their side today. In just a few short hours, the laundry room is finally ivy-free, ready for the installation of a guest washing machine.
We're nearly done. We're just wiping down all the cobwebs, getting all the dust off the shelves. Just, I thought, well, while we're absolutely filthy, I might as well do the really filthy job. But yeah, absolutely chuff what we've got done. It'll be a laundry in no time.
The couple are slowly chipping away at their to-do list, but they haven't even started work on the Gite interior, and soon Maxine will be flying solo as Graham is due to start remote working for a client in the UK.
A big job, that.
A lot bigger than we expected. But it's done, I can get on now.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're at work from now, but at least I can get on inside. But I couldn't have done that on my own.
No.
next big project really is to get the Gîte up and running properly, isn't it?
Yeah. And we'll tie the dog out as well.
Dog shattered again.
And with just 4 weeks to go before their first guests arrive, there's a danger Maxine may soon be feeling the same way as she tackles the Gîte interior alone. Coming up, renovation fatigue sets in for Sarah and Luther.
We came here with all great plans, and 4 weeks later, we seem to have made more mess than we actually started with.
And emotions run high.
A bit emotional. It's been a dream for a long time, so it's like almost like now today's the day. The dream becomes reality, really.
On Jeanette and Fraser's move day.
I'm just praying we can get it all in.
Back on the Costa del Sol, it's late March, and Sarah and Luther are getting ready to welcome a trial guest at their B&B. But while they have one room fit for a king, other areas of the villa have yet to receive the Royal Seal of Approval.
We came here with all great plans, and 4 weeks later, we seem to have made more mess than we actually started with. But we're getting more and more into the Spanish way of life with the Tranquila. But I think it'll all come together this week, especially with him being around, that I'll try and get a few more things done when we've got 5 minutes to clue tiles back on, clean things down, and by the time the next guest arrives, it's going to be perfect.
But while Luther is tranquilo, Sarah is tense. To live and work in Spain full-time, they must secure residency. The couple are applying for golden visas, a status granted to Brits who invest in the region. But even for a barrister, the process is complex.
The golden visa documents are quite extensive, so we've got to get all of that sorted out and then lodge our application within 90 days of purchasing this property. Luther's very relaxed about the application. I'm not so relaxed about it. There's a lot of red tape out here, and I'm just getting a bit anxious about the time frame.
Visas or not, they're keen to push forward with their B&B plans. So while Luther heads to the airport to pick up trial guest Ash, Sarah does one last room check.
Well, the difficulty is the iron we have isn't very good, so the bed's a bit creased, but it's brand new. Bedding, brand new cushions, brand new pillows. Everything's new. Just a bit creased.
Ash will be staying at the B&B for free.
If you'd like to come this way, sir, if you look left, you can see the sea in Fuengirola. And this, sir, is your room.
All that Sarah and Luther expect in return is his honest opinion.
The arrangement that we've come to is the fact that I'm going to treat him like a guest that I would normally, and I want 100% proper feedback. That's the arrangement.
I'm fully confident that Luther knows what he's doing, and whatever he does normally ends up success anyway, so he's a people person.
Cheers! Cheers, Willie. Happy holidays.
Thank you.
It's 4 days later, and Ash is enjoying his stay so much that he's postponed his return flight to take in more of what the area has to offer.
You can't get a better view than that there, can you?
And Ash hasn't been shy of sharing his feedback.
What we've discovered with Ash staying here is that the noise travels up from the bedroom up into our lounge area because it's all open on the staircase. We discovered this because obviously Monty's playing on his games and Ash can hear him at night, so this is the feedback that we wanted.
Luckily, the estate agent who sold them the villa has come to the rescue.
So what I'd like to do is put two doors in downstairs.
By introducing Luther to some local tradesmen.
So what we're going to need here is a door to stop the clients coming from there up into our house so that we can...
Private.
And also quiet. I could do a door myself, but it probably wouldn't close properly. It'd probably squeak and fall off its hinges. So Sarah's had enough of me saying I can do something and then not, and I know what I'm capable of. And a door, let's put a door in properly.
But there's a bigger issue stopping Sarah and Luther from opening the B&B.
OK. Cheers, pal.
They just discovered they're missing one vital document needed to open.
We bought the property with a tourism licence and so expected it to be transferred to us on completion, and we discovered that it hadn't been, and so we've got to get that sorted out before we can formally trade.
Without a tourism licence, the couple's B&B plans are dead in the water. And with no permanent visas either, the family's Spanish dream could be over before it's begun. Back in Mojaca, after a busy few days painting and decorating the restaurant, Jeanette and Fraser are ready to receive an important and rather large delivery.
We're waiting for the whole restaurant to arrive now. It was all packed up 2 weeks ago, so we don't know what state everything's in. We've got olive trees on it, plants on it, food on it, tables and chairs, catering equipment, light fittings. Quite an exciting day to see it all again, because we've kind of been forgetting what we had. It's all coming together. Looks like we're going to have a restaurant at some point over the next 2 weeks.
But Jeanette is a little worried that it may not all fit in.
I'm a little bit concerned about the amount of space we have to bring everything inside at the moment, because we don't have a toldos on the front, so it's all very open. And the kind of furniture we have, we can't actually leave it out on the front. So that's a little bit concerning, but I'm sure it'll all come somewhere. I'm just praying we can get it all in.
Outside, the truck has arrived. And first off is Jeanette's centrepiece for the outside terrace.
We've just taken delivery now of the olive tree that's been with me for the last 5 years. It's 102 years old, this olive tree, would you believe? It looks in better nick than I do.
Under Jeanette's watchful eye...
Over there with them, that'll be fine.
Everything is given a place.
Down the bottom, please. Shove them under the tables if you can, love.
And as the restaurant begins to fill up, Jeanette begins to well up.
A bit emotional. It's been a dream for a long time, so it's like almost like now today's the day. The dream becomes reality, really.
After 2 hours of heavy lifting, the restaurant is packed to the rafters.
We're nearly there. I can see the back of the truck. Thank God, because there's no more room in this restaurant until we unpack it all. Oh, wow. It's going to be a slog now, unpacking all this.
Thankfully, they managed to squeeze the last few items in.
Right there.
And Fraser and Jeanette now have themselves a fully furnished restaurant, albeit in a bit of a mess.
I'm sure it'll be fine by the end of the day. It's my positive head. It'll look a bit better by the time we've emptied a few boxes and put them into shelves. But it's here, and now we've just got to get open. So it's all hands to the deck, I think is what they say, isn't it? Just everybody keep going. This is the hardest part, I think, putting everything away and finding homes and making it feel like an olive tree. Curtains to go up, plants to be replanted and put in pots, loads of things. I'm excited now. I can't wait.
But the restaurant furniture wasn't the only thing to arrive today. So did the quote for the new extractor fan, which isn't quite as exciting.
We went on the roof last week and there's no motor for the extractor. So we've had a quote for that, for a new motor, installation, taxes, looking at €1,000.
With money getting tighter, they need to get the restaurant trading.
It's just obviously waiting on things that are out of our control. Fans and electric and plumbing. But everything else is going to the timetable.
But with just 3 weeks to get both the bar and kitchen set up, there's a lot of hard work and a bit of luck required if they're going to hit their planned opening deadline. Next time...
Don't panic, Mr. Mannering!
Sarah and Luther learn the value of the phrase measure twice, cut once.
I've done a good job on that, apart from the fact that it's the wrong way around. Butchered it.
Jeanette and Fraser prepare to open their beachside restaurant.
We've already got 20 people booked in.
But will patio problems end their dream before it's begun?
We had a quotation for a new one, €14,000. €14,000 is a lot of money.
And Maxine and Graham make an unusual find at their rural retreat.
There is absolutely no way that is staying in the Gite.